professor of physiology and laboratory. I am starting a new channel on YouTube for the professor. I will explain in detail all the important information regarding medical physiology, pathology and practice of medicine. The purpose of starting a new channel is to offer my brethren a ready reference and students who seek help for understanding these basic subjects. Medicine is forever enlarging branch. Each subject has its own peculiarities and importance in the practice. Day by day, the horizon is expanding. The profession demands strict discipline in terms of study, time and performance. It is the study of science and its skillful employment. Now, in order to fulfill this goal, a physician should have the knowledge of structure, that is anatomy, the knowledge of function, that is physiology, and knowledge of the disease, that is pathology. And to practice, he must have the knowledge how to employ this in the practice. To fulfill this goal, let us start with the basic subject of medicine, that is human physiology. Now, physiology is the study of various functions of systems and organs of the body. Physiology is the science that seeks to explain the physical and chemical mechanisms that are responsible for the origin, development and progression of life. Human physiology is usually studied under following headings. These headings are general physiology, blood and its constituents, nerve and muscle physiology, cardiovascular physiology, respiratory physiology, gastrointestinal physiology, renal physiology, the endocrine system, reproductive physiology, the nervous system and special senses. First of all, let us start with general physiology. Now, general physiology is a branch of physiology concerned with the basic functional activities of living matter. Cell is the basic structural and functional unit of the body. Each organ is an aggregate of many different cells. Each type of cell is specially adapted to perform one or a few particular functions. The entire body contains about 100 trillion cells. All of them have certain basic characteristics that are alike. The two major parts of the cell are nucleus and cytoplasm. The nucleus is separated from the cytoplasm by a nuclear membrane. The cytoplasm is separated from the surrounding fluids by a cell membrane, also called plasma membrane. The different substances that make up a cell are collectively called protoplasm. Now, the protoplasm is composed of mainly five basic substances. These substances are water, electrolytes, proteins, lipids and carbohydrates. Now, water is principal fluid medium of each and every cell except fat cells. It is present in most cells in a concentration of 70 to 85%. Important ions or electrolytes of the cell include potassium, magnesium, sulfate, bicarbonate and smaller quantities of sodium, chloride and calcium. After water, the most abundant and important substances in most cells are proteins that normally constitute 10 to 20% of the cell mass. These proteins are divided into two basic types: structural proteins and functional proteins. Lipids constitute only 2% of the total cell mass. Especially important lipids are phospholipids, cholesterol and triglycerides. Carbohydrates have little structural function in the cell. They play a major role in the nutrition of the cell. Most human cells do not maintain large stores of carbohydrates. The amount usually averages about 1% of total cell mass. The amount increases about 3% in muscle cells and about 6% in liver cells. Let us take physical structure of the cell. Each cell is formed by cell membrane, cytoplasm and nucleus. Let us consider cell membrane first. Cell membrane is a thin, pliable and elastic structure only 7.5 to 10 nanometers thick. It is composed of proteins and lipids. The approximate composition is proteins are 55%, phospholipids are 25%, cholesterols are 13%, other lipids are 4%, and carbohydrates are 3%. Now let us consider lipid layer of the cell membrane. The central lipid layer is a bilayered structure. It is composed of phospholipids, sphingolipids and cholesterol. Phospholipid molecules are arranged in two layers. The outer part is called head portion and the inner part is called tail portion. The head portion is soluble in water and is known as hydrophilic portion. The tail portion is insoluble in water and is known as hydrophobic portion. Hydrophobic tail portions meet in the center. Hydrophilic head portions of outer layer face the extracellular fluid and those of the inner layer face the cytoplasm. Cholesterol molecules are arranged in between the phospholipid molecules. Now functions of the lipid layer. Lipid layer is semi-permeable membrane and it allows only fat-soluble substances like oxygen, carbon dioxide and alcohol to pass through it. Now we are taking protein layers of the cell membrane. Protein layers cover the two surfaces of lipid layer. They are classified into two categories. Integral or transmembrane proteins that pass through the entire thickness of cell membrane and peripheral proteins which are embedded in outer and inner surfaces of cell membranes. The examples are receptors, transport proteins, enzymes and adhesion proteins. Now we are considering functions of protein membrane. Now, integral proteins provide structural integrity. Channel proteins help in diffusion of water-soluble substances like glucose and electrolytes. Carrier proteins help in transport of substances across the cell membrane. Proteins act as pumps by which ions are transported. Receptor proteins serve as receptor sites for hormones and neurotransmitters. Some of the protein molecules form the enzymes and control chemical reactions within the cell membrane. Some proteins act as antigens and induce antibody formation. Now let us consider carbohydrates of cell membrane. Carbohydrates are either attached to proteins and known as glycoproteins or proteoglycans, or they are attached to lipids and known as glycolipids. Carbohydrate molecules form a thin and loose covering layer over the entire surface of cell membrane called glycocalyx. So, now we take functions of cell membrane. Cell membrane protects the cytoplasm and organelles. It acts as semi-permeable membrane. which allows only some substances to pass through it and acts as a barrier for other substances. Nutrients are absorbed into the cell through the cell membrane. Metabolites and waste products from the cell are excreted out through the cell membrane. Exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide take place through the cell membrane, and cell membrane maintains the shape and the size of the cell. Now we take cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is a jelly-like material formed by 80% of water. It is made up of two zones, ectoplasm and endoplasm. Now we consider organelles in cytoplasm. Organelles are the small organs of the cell. Some of them are bound by limiting membrane and others do not have limiting membrane. Organelles with limiting membranes are endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, lysosomes, peroxisomes, centrosomes and centrioles, secretory vesicles, mitochondria, nucleus, and organelles without limiting membranes are ribosomes and cytoskeleton. Now first we can consider endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum is a network of tubular and vesicular structures. It contains a fluid medium called endoplasmic matrix. The endoplasmic reticulum forms the link between the nucleus and cell membrane. Endoplasmic reticulum is of two types, rough endoplasmic reticulum and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Rough endoplasmic reticulum is rough, bumpy and bead-like structure. The rough appearance is due to attachment of granular ribosomes to its outer surface. The rough endoplasmic reticulum is concerned with synthesis of proteins and degradation of worn out materials. Smooth endoplasmic reticulum is formed by many interconnected tubules. It does not have a ribosomal attachment. It is concerned with formation of non-protein substances such as steroids and cholesterols. This type of endoplasmic reticulum is abundant in cells that are involved in synthesis of lipids, phospholipids, lipoproteins, steroid hormones and sebum. Outer surface of smooth endoplasmic reticulum contains many enzymes which are involved in many metabolic processes. It is the major site of storage and metabolism of calcium, and it is also concerned with catabolism and detoxification of toxic substances like some drugs and carcinogens. Now we'll take Golgi apparatus. Golgi apparatus is a membrane-bound organelle. It is present in all the cells except red blood cell. It is named after the discoverer Camillo Golgi. Each Golgi apparatus contains 5 to 8 flattened membranous sacs called cisterna. Golgi apparatus has two ends or face. They are known as cis-face or trans-face. The cis-face is positioned near endoplasmic reticulum. Reticular vesicles from endoplasmic reticulum enter the Golgi apparatus from here. The transphase is situated near the cell membrane. The processed substances make their exit from the transphase. The Golgi apparatus is concerned with processing, packaging and labeling of materials. Glycoproteins and lipids are modified and processed. They are packed in the form of vesicles, secretory granules and lysosomes, which are transported to other part of the cell or out of the cells. Now we will consider lysosomes. Lysosomes are formed by Golgi apparatus. They have the thickest covering membrane. Lysosomes are of two types. Primary lysosomes, which is pinched off from Golgi apparatus. It is inactive in spite of having hydrolytic enzymes. And secondary lysosome, which is active form. It is formed by fusion of primary lysosome with other substance. Lysosomes are called garbage system of the cell because of their degradation activity. About 50 different hydrolytic enzymes are present in lysosomes. Important lysosomal enzymes are proteases, which hydrolyze proteins into amino acids, lipases, which hydrolyze lipids into fatty acids and triglycerides, amylases, which hydrolyze carbohydrates into glucose. Lysosomes are concerned with degradation of macromolecules, worn out organelles, removal of excess secretory products in the cell. Now we will take peroxisomes. Peroxisomes are pinched off from endoplasmic reticulum. They contain oxidative enzymes such as catalase, uratoxylase, and D-amino acid oxidase. Peroxisomes are concerned with breakdown of fatty acids by means of beta oxidation, degradation of toxic substances like hydrogen peroxide, formation of major site of oxygen utilization in the cells, acceleration of gluconeogenesis from fats, and in the formation of myelin and bile acids. Now we'll take mitochondrion. Mitochondrion is a rod-shaped or oval-shaped structure with a diameter of 0.5 to 1 micron. The outer membrane is smooth. The inner membrane is folded in the form of self-like projections called Krishna. Krishna contain many enzymes and proteins which are involved in respiration and synthesis of adenosine triphosphate, which is known as ATP. Mitochondria are concerned with production of energy and synthesis of ATP. Now we'll take ribosomes. Ribosomes are organelles without limiting membrane. They are granular and small dot-like structure with a diameter of 15 nanometer. Ribosomes are of two types: ribosomes that are attached to endoplasmic reticulum and free ribosomes. Ribosomes are called protein factories. Messenger RNA carries genetic code for protein synthesis from nucleus to ribosomes. The ribosomes arrange the amino acids into protein. Now we will consider the third important part of the cell, that is nucleus. Nucleus is the most prominent and the largest cellular organelle. It has a diameter of 10 to 22 microns and occupies 10% of total cell volume. Nucleus is present in all the cells of the body except red blood cells. The cells with nucleus are called eukaryotes, and cells without nucleus are called prokaryotes. Presence of nucleus is necessary for cell division. Nucleus is covered by a membrane called nuclear membrane, and it contains many components. Major components of nucleus are nucleoplasm, chromatin, and nucleolus. Nuclear membrane is double-layered and porous in nature. The pores are lined by proteins. Exchange of materials between nucleoplasm and cytoplasm occurs through these pores. Nucleoplasm is a highly viscous fluid that forms the ground substance of the nucleus. It surrounds chromatin and nucleolus. It contains matrix, nucleotides, and enzymes. The nuclear matrix form the structural framework for organizing chromatin. Chromatin is a thread-like material made up of deoxyribonucleic acid, which is known as DNA. Just before the cell division, the chromatin condenses to form chromosomes. Chromosome is a rod-shaped nuclear structure. It is formed from a single DNA molecule coiled around histone molecules. Chromosomes are visible only during cell division under microscope. All the dividing cells of the body except reproductive cells contain 23 pairs of chromosomes known as diploid cells. Each pair consists of one chromosome inherited from mother and one chromosome from the father. Among 23 pairs, one pair is concerned with determination of the sex of the person. These chromosomes are called sex chromosomes. Among sex chromosomes, one is called X chromosome and another one is called Y chromosome. The cells of the females have two chromosomes, which are X chromosomes, and cells of the males have two chromosomes, which are one X chromosome and one Y chromosome. Remaining 22 pairs are called autosomes. The reproductive cells called gametes or sex cells contain only 23 single chromosomes. The cells are called haploid cells. Nucleolus is a small, round, granular structure which contains RNA and some proteins. Now we are considering functions of nucleus. Nucleus controls all the activities of the cells. It synthesizes the RNA, ribonucleic acid. It helps in formation of subunits of ribosomes. Nucleus sends genetic instruction to cytoplasm for protein synthesis through messenger RNA or mRNA. It controls the cell division through genes. It stores the hereditary information and transforms this information from one generation to the next. Now we will take deoxyribonucleic acid or DNA. DNA is a double-stranded complex nucleic acid. It is formed by deoxyribose, phosphoric acid, and four types of bases. Each DNA molecule consists of two polynucleotide chains, which are twisted around one another in the form of double helix. The two chains are formed by the sugar, deoxyribose, and phosphate. The deoxyribose and phosphate form the backbone of DNA. Both chains of DNA are connected with each other by some organic bases. Now, each nucleotide is formed by deoxyribose, which is a sugar, phosphate, and one of the following organic bases. Purines are either adenine or guanine, and pyrimidines are either thymine or cytosine. The adenine of one strand binds with the thymine of opposite strand. The cytosine of one strand binds with the guanine of the other strand. The hereditary information encoded in the DNA is called a genome. Each DNA molecule is divided in discrete units called genes. Now, gene is the basic hereditary unit of the cells. It contains message or code for synthesis of specific protein from amino acids. In the nucleotide of DNA, three of the successive base pairs are called a triplet or codon. Each codon codes for one amino acid. There are 20 amino acids, and there is separate code for each amino acids. Now we will consider ribonucleic acid, that is known as RNA. It contains a long chain of nucleotide. It is similar to DNA, but it contains ribose instead of deoxyribose. Each nucleotide is formed by ribose sugar, phosphate, one of the following organic bases in which purines are adenine and guanine, pyrimidines are uracil and cytosine. Now, types of RNA. RNA are of three types. The first is messenger RNA or mRNA which carries genetic code for the amino acid sequence for synthesis of protein from DNA to cytoplasm. Second is transfer RNA or tRNA which is responsible for decoding of genetic message present in the mRNA. And the third is ribosomal RNA or rRNA. It is responsible for assembly of protein from amino acids in the ribosomes. Now we'll consider gene expression. It is the process by which the information encoded in the gene is converted into functional gene product that is used for protein synthesis. It involves two steps, transcription and translation. Transcription means copying. It indicates copying of genetic code from DNA to messenger RNA. The messenger RNA enters the cytoplasm and activates the ribosome for protein synthesis. Translation of genetic code. The messenger RNA moves out of the nucleus into cytoplasm. Ribosomes get attached to it. The sequence of codons are recognized by transfer RNA. According to sequence, different amino acids are transported from cytoplasm to ribosomes by transfer RNA. With the help of ribosomal RNA, the protein molecules are assembled from amino acids. Hello guys, thank you for watching this video. Please like, share and subscribe our channel Medic Talks and also comment your suggestion. We'll upload new video in a short time. Thank you.